لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم، وأكرمنا بنور الفهم، وافتح علينا بمعرفة العلم، وسهل أخلاقنا بالحلم، واجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. اللهم اجعل أعمالنا خالصة لوجهك، ولا تجعل فيها حظا لغيرك. وصل اللهم على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
How's everyone today? الحمد لله. We were busy with سورة ال وبزي with سورة الملك. And we ended on verse number 5. I'll just read a couple of verses and continue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وهو العزيز الغفور الذي خلق سبع سماوات طباقا ما ترى في خلق الرحمن من تفاوت فارجع البصر هل ترى من فطور ثم ارجع البصر كرتين ينقلب إليك البصر خاسئا وهو حسير ولقد زينا السماء الدنيا بمصابيح وجعلناها رجوما للشياطين وأعتدنا لهم عذاب السعير. So we mentioned at the very beginning of the surah. Just give me a second. At the very beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started off by expressing his or introducing us to his majesty, and in addition to his majesty, the fact that he is the source of goodness, the source of abundance, and the source of blessings. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned a number of things. One is that all things belong to him. Everything is in his ownership, and he has the ability to do all things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went on, tells us, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. After speaking about himself, he speaks about himself in relation to our own, the journey of our lives here. Right? And he says that life and death, or death and life, it is there to test us, which are, or who of us are best in deeds. And then Allah says, he is Al-Aziz Al-Ghafoor. And after that verse we said, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting, in his highlighting of two of his names is creating a paradigm for us with which to view the world. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that has everything, the one that's a source of abundance, the one that has the ability to do everything, he can either manifest that in relation to you through his name Al-Aziz, meaning if you live your life, or in that cycle of life and death, what you choose to exhibit is disobedience, then that can be met with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's might. And if you choose to exhibit repentance or striving towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be met with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's quality of maghfirah. Then after that, the discussion somewhat changed. Allah again spoke about his creation, but not about a conceptual thing, about the material creation that's in front of us. He's the one that created the seven heavens in layers. And then Allah says, مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوْتِ. You don't see any incoherence or incongruence in the creation of Allah, in the creation of the Most Merciful. Importantly, I can't remember if we spoke about it, but how Allah introduces the discussion by referring to Himself as most merciful. He's going to shortly after this speak about the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very shortly going to refer to Himself as, or is going to speak about people burning in the hellfire in actually very vivid terms. But he introduces the discussion by saying that this is the creation of Ar-Rahman. And you know some of the meanings of Ar-Rahman. What's the first thing that comes to mind? Okay, mercy, yes, but like I told, yeah, mercy is so cold, man. That understanding of like motherly mercy, if you want, right? That understanding of motherly mercy, it's more than, it's a warm type of mercy, not the mercy that the king may show to his subjects, but that that the mother may show to her child. Obviously, walillahi al-mathalul a'la, to Allah belongs the, you know, the most exalted of examples. We don't liken Allah to any creation in any way. But the closest thing that we may know to what rahmah means is motherly love and motherly mercy. Right? So Allah introduces a discussion like that. You do not see in the creation of this lovingly merciful being any incoherence or any incongruence. فَرُجَعِ الْبَصَرَ هَلْ تَرَى مِنْ فُطُورِ Look again, do you see any cracks? ثُمَّ رُجَعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ Then look again and again. يَنْقَلِبَ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِيًا Your sight will return to you in failure and fatigued. وَهُوَ حَسِيرٌ Whilst it will be, how can I say, dejected, or it will come back with regret and tired. خَاسِيًا and حَسِيرٌ have a similar meaning. But one has the element of failure, the other one has the element of regret. But both of them actually mean to be fatigued as well. So, at the end of last week's discussion, we were speaking about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to His creation, but He refers to His creation, or our outlook upon His creation, in a somewhat negative way. Right? We're looking into the creation to find fault. Right? Allah tells, and Allah challenges you, look into creation, see if you see any flaws. And the result of that pursuit, Allah mentions as well. The result of that pursuit is, if you make that your pursuit, you will fail. Your eyes will come back to you tired. Right? You will fail in that pursuit. But after, you know, that doubt and that skepticism is removed, now one starts to see the divine beauty in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, one starts to see the creation not as a cold, lifeless collection of atoms that just accidentally got arranged in certain ways, where in fact no two things are different from each other in terms of the basic makeup. Like, I don't want to get off on a tangent now, but like a human being no different to a rock. Where all these atoms know, you start seeing that there's beauty in things, that there's purpose in things, that there's that there's a divine will at play. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَا صَابِيحًا Allah moves from speaking about His creation. But remember, when Allah spoke about His creation in the first verse, He didn't speak about it as if the creation is a negative thing. He actually introduced our thinking about the creation as that we should be thinking of it as creation of that being that's most merciful to me. So the fact that He created is all expressions of His mercy to me. He is the being that has mercy to the nth degree. Our minds cannot fathom the extent of His mercy. Right? And when we think of the creation as being the creation of that being, we think of His creation as being mercy to us. Right? But the human condition doesn't always see like that. Humans have a tendency to be skeptical. Human beings have a tendency to seek out flaw. So Allah says, if you were to try and do that on the creation of that merciful being, whose creation you should be seeing as a mercy to you, you will fail. And after failing in that pursuit, then know what? That that same being, Allah, Ar-Rahman, He beautified the heaven, As-Sama' al-Dunya, the lowest heaven. He beautified it and He adorned it with stars. Bimasabiha. Allah is referring to stars, but the masabih, a misbah is actually a lamp. It's actually a lamp, right? So we understand therefrom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed these stars in the sky and they give us light. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that's where we start, right? Right. وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ. Allah says, we have adorned the worldly heaven, the lowest heaven, with stars. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا جَعَلَ يَجْعَلُ means what? Ja'ala means to make or place or so. But yeah, we mean to make. Wa ja'alna, who is the fa'il?
We.
Ja'ala. And if you go down the scale, you're going to get to ja'alna. How do I know that na is the fa'il and it's a maf'ul? No, na is fixed. How do I know that it's we made and not He made us?
It's a damir.
He made us would sound how? Ja'alana. Ja'alna means we. So if you want a quick way to look for it, just see what's before the na'i. It's a sukoon. Then it's going to be your fa'i. In most cases, yeah, almost in every case probably. جعلنا So and we made ها means what? Literally ها, right? Feminine means in this context what is it referring to? The stars, the مصابيح. I told you the word مصابيح is a plural of the word مصباح. جعلناها. We made. So now you're going to translate it as them, meaning the stars, because it's a plural. But you also remember the rule, right? When you جمع غير عاقل plural of an inanimate object, we treat it as a singular feminine. That's why we're using هايا, right? So وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِحَ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا. And we made them, the stars. What did we make them? رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. Rujuman. The root, so what's the root of this word? Ra, Jim, Mim. Rujum. What does that mean? What do you know from there? You know the word Rajm? Rajm means to stone something. And it can also mean to outcast. We use these words often. Shaytanir, Rajim. Same root, isn't it?
Yes.
So what does it mean? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek protection in Allah from Satan the. We translate it as the cursed. It means the outcast one, the one that was kicked out of heaven, the one that was, and in that sense a curse. So rujuman means either to outcast something or to stone them. So it says, وَجَعَلْنَاهَا Rujuman, we made them, the stars, as things with which to cast out. Rujuman, things with which to cast out or to pelt. To pelt what? As peltings, li shayatin, for the devils, for the shayatin, yeah, for the devils. This word rujum is a plural of the word rajum, which is actually a masdar, infinitive, but it has the meaning here of a maf'ul bihi, which means something with which you pal. That so Allah says, and we made them, the stars, as things with which we pelt the shayateen. وجعلناها رجوما للشياطين وأعتدنا لهم عذاب السعير. Allah says, وأعتدنا. The root, it is عين تا دال. عين تا دال. And the verb here is أعتد يعتد. أعتد يعتد. Did you learn how far you were the مزيد في skills? You started, so by the second one, fa'ala, you started today. Okay, this is number four. This is the fourth skill, right? So the verb is a'tada yu'atidu. So what do you think a'tadna is going to be? A'tadna. Is the na fa'il or maf'ul? Fa'il again, what's before it? Sukun, right? So even though you don't know this verb, you can still see that, right? وَأَعْتَدْنَا. أَعْتَدَ means to prepare something. To prepare. We know this word also. What's the names? We call the names of the angels on our shoulders. رَقِيب and عَتِيد. عَتِيد. رَقِيب is watching. عَتِيد means ready. أَعْتَدَ means to prepare. أَعْتَدْنَا will mean what? And we prepared. لَهُمْ. لا حرف الجر. What does it mean? For whom? Them. That's going to be my ism al-majrur, right? For them. What did we prepare for them? We referring to Allah. What is it? What did we prepare for them? What's the maf'ul of the verb a'tadna? Maf'ul must be in which hal? Maf'ul must be in halatul nasb, right? What's the? Adaba. Adaba. But before we even translate adaba, you should know what it means already. But what kind of word is it? I mean, what can you see about the word? Adaba. Light word, right? No al, no tanween. And the word that follows it? Injar. So what kind of construction do we have there? Mudaf, mudaf in light. Adaba sa'iri. What does that mean? We prepared for them the punishment of a sa'ir. A sa'ir means like a blazing fire. وأعتدنا لهم عذاب السعير. We prepared for them a blazing fire. Kindled fire also, if you want. So now, I mean, how's the progression in that verse? What's the progression in that verse? Allah starting with speaking about His material creation. Allah is speaking about His material creation. What material creation? He's speaking about stars in the sky. Allah is speaking about the beauty of stars in the sky as well. And then after Allah mentions that, Allah refers to these stars as masabih. Right? There's benefit to that. There's other words for stars in Arabic. Allah could have used the word nujum. Najm means a star as well. There's other words for stars as well. Kaukabun is a more normal word for stars. Allah could have used any of those words, but Allah specifically chose to use the word misbah. So in what the word itself, the word usage itself brings something to mind. So I know that it's referring to the stars, but in addition to it just referring to the stars, it also highlights certain benefits that I derive from stars. So like Allah is telling you that He adorned the sky with lamps for you. Usually when do you use a lamp? In darkness, and you use it at night. And so here Allah is telling you, there's a similarity between these stars and lamps. You bring out your lamps at night to give you light, but I've already placed lamps for you in the sky. And elsewhere Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers in the Quran to benefits that we derive from stars as well. Allah mentions that they adorn the skies. Allah mentioned that you use them to navigate and for guidance. And the idea of masabih also has that in it. That they allow you to see better. But elsewhere Allah refers to the aspect of guidance more clearly. And then Allah mentions another thing, and that thing is that He uses them to with which to pelt the shayateen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in a little bit more detail in another surah. He says, إِلَّا مَنِ اسْتَرَقَ السَّمْعَ فَأَتْبَعَهُ شِهَابٌ مُبِينٌ. In another verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this, and then He says that some of the shayateen, and we refer to the bad jinnat as shayateen, they go up to the heavens, but they don't have access to, like, to go beyond the samawat or enter Jannah or anything like that. So they go as close as possible, and then istaraqa sam'a is the word that Allah uses. They steal some audible information. They steal a hearing, basically. So what they do is, Mufassirin say, they go up as close to they can as Allah's audience with angels, and they try to hear what commandments are being given to the angels, etc. But then Allah says what happens to them is فَأَتْبَعَهُ شِهَابٌ مُبِينٌ. And then Allah causes a shihab, which is like an ember or something, to follow them. So Allah cast them out with stars. Yeah, Allah could be referred to that. So that reality. And you know, just as a side point, that's why some people say, how is it that you have soothsayers that sometimes get things right? How is it that you have people that can sometimes inform you of things and they get it right? And they maybe even pretty precise in what they can tell you. So some scholars would say they're working with jinn that try to steal information from the samawat. But the reality of that is that none of that's visible to us. Anybody seen it? Anybody seen a shaitan there getting caught? Right? So there's a progression in this verse. Allah started off speaking about His creation, right? Creation of life and death. And that's something that though we don't see it, we experience it. Right? Certainly us of all people, we of all creation, we experience life and death. We are conscious of the fact that we are living. I mean, what did Descartes say? I think, therefore I am. That's one mathematician, philosopher, René Descartes. He said he was looking to prove the existence of God, but then he got into a bit of an issue because he said, well, you know, if I'm trying to prove the existence of God, how do I prove that I'm even alive? So he said, well, I mean, this all may be a dream, I don't know. But the mere fact that I'm thinking tells me that I must be alive. And then he came up with this dualism of mind and matter and stuff like that. But he said, I think, therefore I am. So in fact, his proof of the fact that he exists is that he has thought. So we of all creation can experience that cycle of life and death, and we're conscious about it. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went on to speak about His creation in general, look at the earth, look at the skies of Allah. Do you see any cracks? Allah is just exhorting you to look at His creation physically. Physically. And then Allah introduces you to another dimension of His creation. That's the beauty of His creation. But the specific creation that He uses is one that has a visible reality, that has a reality beyond what our eyes see, a physical reality beyond what our eyes see, and then an unseen reality. So it's as if Allah is taking us on a trajectory. Because when I think of a star, what do I think of? What do you think of when you think about a star? Okay, you think about light. You may think about twinkling, isn't it?
Mm.
Twinkling stars in the sky. That's a beautiful image, but what else do you think about? If you just think a little bit deeper than what your eye sees.
Billions of them.
Okay, you think that there's billions of them? Okay, they're far away. What else? Don't you think about the size of stars?
Mm-hmm.
That this small thing, this thing that looks in my sight like this, a little twinkling thing. When I think a little bit deeper, I research a little bit deeper, then I know that there's a reality to the star beyond what my naked eye sees. Right? Beyond, but it's still a physical reality. That this thing is super huge, it might even be bigger than the earth itself. And though the earth is filled with them, these are creations that are like huge, huge creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is like taking you on a trajectory. Yeah, you see something with your eye, you see that beautiful twinkling star. But then, with a little bit more thought and a little bit more research, you come to know that that star has a greater physical reality, and it's beyond what your mere eye saw. And then, if you go a little bit further on that path, there are purposes and there are things at play that your eye cannot see at all. But that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So Allah is taking you from the realm of the seen into the realm of the unseen. Just like your eye can't see the size of that star, but based on the research of other people, you don't deny it. Similarly, when you are introduced to information that your eye doesn't have access to, you don't deny it merely on account of the fact that you never saw it. Yeah. So Allah is telling you that this creation is multi-dimensional. And Allah's taking us to the trajectory from looking at the physical to thinking about the ghaib. And that's actually where the discussion is going now. What's Allah going to speak about after this? Allah's going to speak about punishment. And Allah speaks about punishment in relation to these devils. But then Allah's going to bring that punishment back to disbelieving people. But what Allah is getting at is here, don't think on account of the fact that you cannot see that the reality doesn't exist. That the reality doesn't exist. And Imam al-Ghazali rahmatullah speaks about this in one of his books. I think it's Al-Munqidh min al-Dalal. I'm not sure exactly what the English translation is. I think it's called Deliverance from Ida or something like that. The book is translated. But he speaks about levels of knowledge. And he says that, you know, as human beings, we recognize that we go through stages of knowing. And it's folly, it's foolish to actually think in the stage of knowledge that you are, that there's no knowledge beyond that. And the mere fact that in our lives we've experienced or we can recognize that there were times when we didn't have access to the knowledge that we now have knowledge of is a proof to that. So he says, for example, when you were in the womb of your mother, initially you couldn't see, you couldn't hear. Right? And then you get born, you can start perceiving things to some degree, you first have the ability to develop the ability to hear, and then you develop the ability to, actually I think that's before you're born, you develop the ability to hear, and then afterwards you develop the ability to see as well. So when you had the ability to hear, audible knowledge was accessible to you, but visible knowledge or visual knowledge was not accessible to you. And when you attain the ability to see, then audible knowledge was accessible to you, visual knowledge was accessible to you, but you didn't have the same level of cognition like you have, that you develop later in life. And there's theories of cognition as well, maybe those teachers or stuff will have learnt about them, but and people who learn psychology and stuff like that. Maybe you see things more as physical forms, and then you develop later, you develop the ability to perceive things, abstract things. And I can't remember, you know, all those Piaget scooters, I really need it at some point. But you develop in life in terms of the knowledge that's accessible to you. And each time you are able to perceive deeper things, you are able to think deeper, you come to see different aspects of things. You come to see different aspects of things, you come to see different types of realities. And you recognize the deficiency not just of the fact that you didn't know before, but in addition to that, you come to perceive a whole different perspective of things. Like some people would say, I can't remember that story now about the fish and the fisherman and in the water. Let me not go there, I can't remember the exact, but it proves the point that I want to make. So anyways, so Imam Ghazali says, well, beyond the knowledge that you have as human beings, there's other levels of knowledge than the knowledge that one can derive from the senses and the knowledge that one can derive from the rationality. He says that there's knowledge that one can attain through worship, through ilham, inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, normal people, even before ilham, can experience epiphanies. You know, to be honest with you, one, this may sound insane, but maybe it's just because I was doing so much math at the time, and I was in my final year at university, I had to do a project on category theories in math. I chose the topic, but anyways, it was like, I'm telling you, I left that project very late. Astaghfirullah. I was not a very good student. I left that project very late. I think I was like past the due date already. And then I crammed, I just sat in my room for a couple of days and I only went out to eat and make salah, that was it. But I distinctly remember one day I was just thinking about categories the whole day. And one day in my sleep, I figured out some stuff. Like I went to sleep, I didn't, I was thinking about the structure of categories, how to explain. Because it's a pretty deep mathematical concept. But then I woke up and you okay, this is, I need to type this thing out. So it's like these levels of, you know, you can experience, that's not like piety, nothing like that. I don't think you get inspired with mathematics. But it's like you recognize that there's a level of access to knowledge you can have in the type of epiphany or something like that. But then there's stuff beyond that as well. Allah can inspire you with knowledge as well. Allah can inspire you with knowledge that comes through feelings, knowledge that comes through intuition. And after you experience it, you don't deny the reality of it. But if you haven't experienced it, you can't pass judgment on it. So Imam Ghazali says, it's foolish of such a person that hasn't experienced that type of knowledge to deny the existence of that type of knowledge. Just on account of the fact that he didn't experience it. Because you've gone through stages in your own life where you were unable to experience types of knowledge that you now have access to. Right? So similarly, it's foolish to deny something merely on account of the fact that you didn't experience it. And then he says, well, beyond that level, you know, that may be accessible to awliya, etc., there's knowledge of the anbiya that even the awliya don't have access to. The wahif, revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of that type. So even the awliya don't get a revelation that's specific to the anbiya. And it would be foolish of any person merely on account of not having experienced that to deny the reality of that. And so here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is introducing us to the unseen. But the trajectory of the verse is almost as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking us in that course. Merely on account of the fact that you don't have access to it via your senses, don't deny its reality. That would be foolish of you. That would be foolish of you. Because you, in the very first two parts of this verse, just in the reference to Zayyanna and Masabih, Allah showing you that there's parts of knowledge that you don't have direct access to. If you want to see the size of stars, you're either going to need to get some, what you call that thing, some spaceship or some telescope or something of that sort. But immediately with what you just have, your naked senses, you don't have access to it. But it will be foolish of you to deny its reality. So Allah is proving that same point in the verse. وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ. And you know, why I actually pointed that out to you is this. Sometimes, when we read the Quran, I don't know if anybody else experiences this, but I must be honest, when I initially, you know, I was quite a bit younger, not that I'm really old, quite young, so alhamdulillah, but I would read the Quran and I think to myself, you know, sometimes it seems like Allah is jumping from topic to topic. Like, how do we go from beautiful stars to pelting devils? And sometimes if one just looks at it superficially, it seems incoherent. It seems like there isn't a natural flow. But that's why the imperative in relation to the Quran, the command that Allah gives in relation to the Quran, is not have you memorized the Quran or no. The imperative in relation to the Quran is that the only one that Allah asks in the Quran is, فَلَا يَتَدَبَّهُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. You're not pondering on the meaning of the Quran. And when you start to ponder the meaning of the Quran, then you see the perfect coherence and connectedness and you know, the logic in the order of the Quran. And so that's actually why I pointed out to you, because in terms of our tafsir, in terms of our understanding of the Quran, we must recognize as a principle the Quran is always connected. The Quran is always coherent. Sometimes it may not be initially apparent to me, but my job then is to ponder. And in that pondering, well, I find the connectedness. Obviously my own pondering and reading the ponderings of other people, which is tafsir, etc. وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحَ وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ وَأَعْتَدْنَا لَهُمْ عَذَابَ السَّعِيرِ. And we prepared for them. For who's them? The only them that we're speaking about is shayateen. We prepared for them, the shayateen, a blazing fire. And then Allah says what? وَلِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. What? And لِلَّذِينَ. What does that mean? We have الَّذِينَ means what? Not the one who, the one who is alladhi. Alladhina is those who, the plural, right? But li and for. Walilladhina and for those who. Lam, harful jar, alladhina, ismul majroor. But we don't see a kasra there because the word is? Fi mahalli jar is correct. It's mabni, it doesn't change. Alladhina doesn't change. Walilladhina and for those who. But we also know about the word alladhina, what do we know about it? It can't stand on its own. Right? I must say the one who what? Or those who what? Those who kafaru. Those who disbelieved. Kafaru. And I told you, what did I tell you about alladhi, alladhina? If it's followed by something that agrees with it in gender and number, you don't even have to look for the file. The file is going to be either inside it or on it, referring back to it. So, I must say those who they disbelieve. Because kafaru literally means kafara, kafaru, they disbelieve. But how that translated? Just those who disbelieve. وَلِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. And for those who disbelieved. But now, who did they disbelieve in? Kafaru, bi is harful jar, rabbi is the word, rab means Lord, him, them. So firstly, what kind of construction is rabbi, him? Rabbi is a light word, isn't it? No al, no tanween. And then it's followed by a damir, which is mabni. So even if it wasn't jar, we wouldn't be able to see. But we should know that it is. Any, and the principle is any damir attached to a noun gives you mudaf, mudafun ilayh. So their Lord. Those who disbelieved, be in their Lord. Now be usually doesn't mean in. Be means with, usually. But you remember, I told you before that verbs are oftentimes used with a harful jar, and then the harful jar takes on a specific meaning in that context, right? Or adds a dimension to the meaning of the verb. So the root kafara is you just used with the harf B. Most of the time when you see the root kafara, you'll see B. And the same like with amana, as used with the harf B. What do you say? Amantu billah. So it's telling you what you believe in. Similarly, kafara, you say kafartu bi, means I disbelieved in something. And like just to illustrate to you that point again, I give you one example. The root taba. What does taba mean? Tawbah. Taba. Taba can have very different meanings depending on which harf you use it with. I can say taba ila, and I can say taba ala. The same taba ila. If I say taba ila, it means to repent. If I say taba ala, then it means to accept repentance. If I say taba ila, it means to turn to something or to repent. If I say taba ala, it means to accept repentance. There are very different meanings, right? And what changed the meaning? Just the harful jar that I used it with, right? Like Allah says in the Quran, ثُمَّ تَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُوا. Allah turned to them so that they could turn back to Him. Allah like accepted their repentance so that they could return. But we all, when we come across that verse, we'll see. The point is just, in this context, B means in, because it's used with the root letters, kafara. وَلِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. And for those who disbelieved in their Lord, what is for them? Remember, we have a sentence, right? Is this jumla ismiya or jumla fi'aliya? Doesn't start with the fi'al, right? Starts with the ism. In fact, it starts with a harf. Right? A harf al-atf and then a harf al-jar. So now, it's not a jumla fi'aliya, it's a jumla ismiya. So we need to find the mubtala and the khabar. So where's the mubtala? And remember the rule, right? The jar or majrur at the beginning? Is that, will that ever be your mubtala? No. The jar or majrur is not going to be your mubtala. So we have here. Wa. Lilladina. Kafarun. Bi. Rabbihim. عذاب جهنم. Can you guys see this? Right. So we said, sorry man,
we said to stay here.
We have a harful jar, right? Then this word is attached to the harful jar, isn't it? Ism al majrur, right? So if we said that harf al-jar ism al-majrur cannot be your mubtada, so then that whole thing is out. But this word kafaru, it's just, isn't that attached to this word? Because that's the ism al-mawsul and that's the sirat al-mawsul. So this word here is attached to that word. And bi rabbihim, is it disconnected from this? No. It's telling you, It's muta'alik, this whole construct that is harful jar, ism al majrur, and the mudaf ilayh. All of this thing is connected to this verb kafaru, saying who they disbelieved in. So all of these words are connected to each other. So I treat them as one thing. So this whole thing can't be my mubtada. So where's my mubtada?
Kafaru. The end.
What comes after that? Adabu. That's my mubtada. That's my mubtada. Adabu, and you can see that it's in raf, right? But also, what else can you see about the word adabu? It's a light word. Question? Yeah, we have three words here, right? B, Rabbi. And him.
The Rabb is also light.
The Rabb is Yes, there is. The Lord of them. But another way of saying the Lord of them, their Lord. That's why I omitted it like. But it is them. So that's a harful jar. That's ismul majrur. That's what I'm saying. Bi Rabbi. And the him is mudafun ilayh. So there's harful jar, ismul majrur, mudafun ilayh. So all of these things are connected. So where's my mutara? Adabu. But adabu also is not on its own. That word there is mudafun ilayh for that. Adabu jahannam. But now you tell me jahannam is supposed to be in jar.
It's a female.
Why are the guys on about it being feminine? Astaghfirullah. No. It's not on account of it being feminine. It's one of those words that's diptot, yes, if you remember the word. It's what we call ghayr munsarif. Right, do you remember that word? I told you get words at mabni, right? Mabni never changes. Right. Mu'rab is opposite of mabni. It changes fully. Then you get words that's in between.
Yeah.
What we call غير منصرف وممنوع من التنوين. What those do is they change halfway.
Yes.
They take a dhamma and they take a fatha.
But not a
kasra. Or tanwin.
Yeah.
Huh? Like. So this guy is actually supposed to have a kasra because it's mudafun ilayh.
Yes.
Huh? But because he only changes halfway. He's sitting with a fatha. So that's that. Jahannam is one of those types of words. What do you call ghayr munsarif?